Swayam Prabha, Digital India, Educated India.
Hello guys, in last video we saw the linear search. We saw how inefficient it is to search a very big number in a very big array. Suppose you have a million of numbers in an array and you want to search a number which is close to million, then it will take around a million of steps to search that number in linear search. So it is very inefficient because you do not have that much of memory power or that much of even time to spend on an array of size 1 million, and that too if the array is sorted. So here what we are going to see is a very good algorithm known as binary search. Whenever you get an array which is sorted either in ascending or descending order, you are getting some extra information which you can use to search any element in that array in very less number of steps. That exactly what we are going to see here. So in the game that you saw in the video, there were two players. One was Ravi and Amit. They were playing a game. So Ravi has an idea that he can guess the number which Amit has thought in a very less amount of iterations. So the game is like this. You guess a number between, let's say, 1 to 1000, and then the second person first computes the midpoint of that array. So in 1 to 1000, the midpoint is 500. Then he asks whether the number that you have guessed is equal to 500 or not. If it is 500, then okay, I got the number. If it is not 500, then he asks whether it is less than 500 or it is greater than 500. So suppose the number you have guessed is less than 500, then you can see that you can safely discard the other 500 elements in the array, because your number will never go beyond 500. You have already said it is less than 500 and the numbers are sorted. So you can never go, you do not have to search the other part of the array. So you can safely discard the numbers from 500 to 1000. So number of elements that you have left now is 1 to 500. Then again, I will compute the midpoint of this array which is left to me, that is 1 to 500, which is the midpoint is 250. Then I will ask you again whether your number is 250. If you says yes, then okay. If he says no, then again I will ask whether it is less than 250 or more than 250. If it is more than 250, then again same logic I will use. Since it is more than 250, I do not have to search it less than 250, because it will never happen that the element will present in the array between 1 to 250. So I can safely discard the numbers from 1 to 250. Now the array which I have left is 250 to 500. Again, I will ask the same question, that is, I will compute that midpoint of 250 to 500 and I will use that midpoint to ask the question and go to the left part of the array and right part of the array. This is the logic of binary search. In this, you are at each iteration, whenever you are computing the midpoint, you are discarding the half part of the array. This way, your size of the array is reducing by 2 at each iteration. So we'll exactly use this logic to do the binary search. So let me write the definition of binary search. Def binary search. It will take two arguments. One is the array. Let's say my array name is A. And the other is the element that I want to search. Great. Now I will create two variables. I will use these variables to position my array. I will create a variable, let's say first position, first pose, which is 0, because the array starts with 0, so I can safely take 0 as my first position. And the last position, which is the last position of the array. Python has a function named as len through which you can compute the length of an array. So suppose if I type len of a, I will get the length of array. Now it gives length of array gives the number of elements in the array, but we know that list or array, whatever you say, in Python starts with 0, so you have to take minus 1. So let me try this in console. Suppose my array name is array 1 and the elements are 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. Okay. Now if you type length of array 1, you'll get how there are 5 elements, so you'll get 5. But the position of 5th element is what? Is actually 4, because the array starts with 0, 0, 1, 2, 3, 4. So suppose you want to retrieve the last element, you will type array 1, and if you type 4 here, you'll get the 5th element. Or you can type array length of this array 1. Okay, this length of array 1 will return the number of elements in array 1, which is 5. So number of elements in array 1 is 5. If I put minus 1 here, so this whole thing means it is 5, which is returned by the length of array 1 minus 1, which is 4. So this will print, give me the 4th element, which is 5. So this is exactly what we are going to do here. So I will put the last position as length of array minus 1. Okay. Also, I will take a flag value which I will use to see whether I found my element or not. Okay. This warning means that all these variables have been, you have created these variables but you are not using it. So as soon as I use it, all these warnings will go. Okay. Now I will create a loop, while loop. Let's see how to do this. And let me write this first and then I will explain it, what exactly I'm trying to do. So I will type first pose is less than last pose and flag is equal to 0. What does this mean? That keep this loop going on until the first position is less than last position, which is these two variables. If first position is always less than last position and flag is equal to 0. I told you flag, you can, let me write a comment here. Flag means that flag equal to 0 means that the element has not been found yet. So it means that you should continue the loop until first position is less than last position and you haven't found the element you are looking for. Till then you have to continue this loop. Okay. So what I will do, first, what was the strategy? So I will first compute the midpoint of the array. So I will compute mid is equal to, right? So I can compute the, in order to compute the midpoint of an array, I will take the first element, the position of first element, I mean the first position of the array, the last position of array, I will add it and divide it by 2. This way I can, iteratively, I can compute the midpoint of any subarray. So I will write first pose plus last pose divided by 2. Now, if I write divide by 2, it will return me a float value. You can check here. Suppose if I do 5 plus 2 divided by 2, it is giving me 3.5. But I exactly want an integer value. So suppose the number is odd, it should give me the integer value either left or right, I don't care much. But it should give me an integer position because it is a position. If I use this float value, then I will not be able to retrieve the element at that position. So I need an integer value. So for that, I will do the there is called as integer division in Python. That is, I will write 5 plus 2 to this division, and it will give me 3. This is what I want, so I will put this one more division operator here, and I'm done. So I've computed the mid. Now what I will check? I will check whether this element x is present in mid or not. I will write if x is equal to a of, because mid is my position, mid. If it is there, then I'm done. I don't have to check for another thing. So I will write, I will make the flag is equal to 1. It means I found the element, and I will write print the element present at position. I can give the position of this mid variable, which is, let me write str mid. You can add +1 also so that you can get the exact position, but I'm not writing it because I'm assuming that you all know that array starts with 0. So I'm, in that context, I'm just printing the mid value. So that's it. You can return from here. It means that whenever you found, you get the element which you are looking for, you can just return it. You do not have to do other computations. I will just return from there. This return will return the function value, which I'm not returning anything. It means it will get out from the function to the main where I'm calling the function. That's it. Okay. Now, if it is not present at the mid position, then I have to check whether it is on the left side or on the right side. So for that, I will write else if it is not present at the mid position. If this x is less than array of mid, which means if x is less than mid, I can discard the right side of the array, which means what? I can safely write that last position is shifted to what? Mid minus 1, because mid and after mid I can discard, because mid is in the first condition I have checked whether it is present at mid or not. If it is not present at mid, then I can discard the mid and all the elements after the mid. So I will safely reduce the size of my array by positioning the last position to mid minus 1. This is why I am discarding the other elements of the array. Or if it is not, if it is not less than the mid, it is more than the mid, then I can discard the first part of the array, which is from 0 to mid, I can discard. For that, I will just shift my first position as first pos is equal to mid plus 1. That's it. Okay. I'm done. My program is over. And if the function doesn't return anything after all these things, it means the array, I didn't find the value which I'm looking for. So I can safely print here after this loop. It means that loop is over, but still I didn't find the element. I will write the number is not present. That's it. Now, in last function, the linear search, we were printing the number of iterations also, how many iterations it takes. So here also I would like to print the number of iteration it is taking to find this value x. So I will create a count variable, count, assign it to 0, and at every iteration of while loop, I will increase the value. Now here I have printed the element where it is present. I will just print that the number of iterations are, which is string of count. Okay, cool. I just need to call this function. So in order to call this function, here I will create an array. So let's say my array name is A, and I will enter the elements in this array for I in range 1 to 500, let's say. A dot append I, and I will call this function, which is binary search, and I have to give the array, and let's say the number I want to search is 70. So our program is complete. So I will just run this program to see the output. Okay, it is showing the number is not present, and I exactly did what the logic was present for the binary search, and I know that number is there. Suppose if I type A, you can see that 70, which I'm looking for, is present, but still it is showing the element is not present. Let me try this for a small number. Let's say number of elements are 10, and what I want to search is 4. Let me try this. Still it is showing that number is not present. Let me see the numbers 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10. And 4 is there. Now what is exactly happening is that whenever the condition that I put here, while first position is less than last position, it might happen that sometime the first position and last position will be the one number. Let's say first position and last position are pointing at 4. At that time, still we have to have one iteration search is required. But this condition will fail, that is first position is less than last position. It is showing that here the first position is not less than last position, it is equal to last position. And here it will fail, and I will not be able to search this element. So to do this, I have to make this condition as less than equal to, which means when first position is less than equal to last position, until then you have to search for the element. Now you can see if I run this, it will show that number is present as position 3, which is 0, 1, 2, 3, and the number of iterations is 4, because 4 times I have to switch to this. Now let's see this. Number of elements will be 101, and I will search for number 70. I'll just run this. See, the number is present at position 69, 70. Now in linear search, what we were looking for, we search for a number, the number of elements we put were 1000, okay, and we were searching for the number 1000, and it was taking 1000 of iteration. Now here, let's see how many iterations it takes. I will run this. See, the number is present as position 999. And in 10 iterations, I was able to search this number in just 10 iterations, where it was taking 1000 iterations in linear search, it takes just 10 iterations in binary search. Suppose I make this 1 million, let's say. Okay, and I want to search this number. Let's say 1 lakh. Okay. See how many iterations it will take. In just 20 iterations, I was able to find the number. Whether, as you all know, to find this number, it would have taken 1 lakh iteration in linear search. So this is the beauty of binary search. You can do, actually it takes exactly log of the number of elements in the array. That is, if the number of elements are, let's say 16, then it will take 4 iterations, 32, then 5 iterations, and so on, 64, then 6 iterations, like this. Because every time you're dividing by 2 and discarding the rest, other part, you're taking only one part at a time. This way, one half of the array is every time discarded, and you are reducing your space by 2, exactly by 2. Every time by 2, it becomes log of 2, log of base 2. So, yeah, we are finished with the binary search. Please, if you have any questions, please post it on discussion forum, or you can, if you think you can, this is a very simple program. If you think you can create a more efficient, more elegant program like this, better than this, please post it on discussion forum. It might help other people to learn. Okay, guys, thank you.
So this is what our next joy is all about. What happened? Didn't get it? Now? Yes, our next joy is about ciphers.
This is personally the most exciting idea throughout the course, at least according to me. We're going to talk about the science of secrecy. If you know what that means. Let me illustrate this with an example. Assume Romeo and Juliet, they want to communicate with each other secretly. How would they go about communicating? Assume Romeo wants to send this long a letter to Juliet, and he suspects that someone in between may probably tamper with the letter and then see what is written. He wants only Juliet to read it. In case someone else gets hold of the letter, they can of course read it, but it should not make sense to them. How would he ensure that he encrypts the letter? A very simple method goes as follows. So this is the letter Romeo wants to write for his sweetheart Juliet. As you can see, it's a long letter. So what he does is he firstly writes the letter and then shifts every single alphabet by 5 units. So which means A becomes F, B becomes G, and so on. So from A to Z, this is what happens to the letters. And this particular letter that Romeo wants to send to Juliet takes this form. And now the letter finally looks something like this. And Romeo sends it to his beloved Juliet. And Juliet gets this and knows what exactly Romeo has done to his original letter. Basically, they have communicated about this protocol beforehand. And what Juliet does is the following, as you would have guessed, obviously, she shifts it back 5 units, which means she makes F, A, G becomes B, and so on. And there you are, she gets the original letter. You see, the shift being 5 is the secret key here. It can be 5 between Romeo and Juliet, and between Laila and Majnu, it can be 15. Now, what if someone gets to know that the method used by the lovers is simply shifting it by some units. And a mediator comes and catches hold of the letter communicated by this boyfriend to his girlfriend. Can he break this code? So this middleman who comes and catches hold of the letter sent by our boy to his girl, he knows that the idea here is shifting every single letter by a few units. So what he does is try all possible shifts. He first tries one shift and tries to see if the text makes sense or not. So whatever you're seeing right now, let us take these three lines text as the letter that the boy writes to his girl, and then it's being shifted by some units that the middleman doesn't know, but he wants to crack it. So he tries assigning A to B, B to C, C to D. By that I mean he assumes it to be one shift and tries to see if the text thus generated makes sense or not. As you can see, it is not making sense. And he tries a 2 shift, and then a 3 shift, and then a 4, and then a 5, and then a 6, and then a 7. And finally, when he does 8, he sees that the shift is actually making sense completely. All the words are English words, and hence he concludes that the shift this boy is using happens to be 8. And there he is. He has deciphered the encrypted text with his little intelligence. So what do you infer from this? Such a method, if used between two people to communicate, can be broken easily by a mediator, a middleman, if he knows, provided that the technique used is shifting, but he doesn't know by what units it's being shifted. So what he does is he tries all possible shifts from shift 1 to shift 25, 26 and so on, right? One of them should give him valid English text. Once he gets the valid English text, he concludes he has decrypted the secret message. What we saw just now is called popularly the Caesar cipher in the literature of cryptography. A very well-known technique, which is not being used mainly for its, because of its simplicity and the fact that anyone can break it. Now, I'm going to teach you a technique which is a little more complicated, rather a lot more complicated than what I explained just now, the Caesar cipher. I'm going to tell you something else which is a lot more complicated, which appears as though nobody can break this. Here is a lot more complicated way of encrypting a given text. And here's how it goes. You take every single English letter and assign a complicated symbol to it. And a Romeo writes a long letter for his Juliet and simply takes every single letter, every single symbol, and instead of using the English alphabet letters, he uses the corresponding symbols that is agreed between Romeo and Juliet. Now, according to what I just now illustrated, A stands for this symbol, B stands for this symbol, and so on up to Z. And Romeo converts his letter, his love letter, to something as complicated looking as this. Now, it looks like it's going to be impossible for anybody to crack this, isn't it? Who on earth knows what letter is mapped to what letter, right? This looks like a perfect way of communicating. Or is it? Is there a way to break even this cipher? Let us take a break and let me tell you all a nice story. A story that looks completely unrelated to what we are talking, but is very related. There was this mom who had 10 sons, all of different heights. And one day, the sons tried playing a prank on their mom. They wore masks, disguising themselves, and they come in front of their mom and then challenge her to identify who is who. All 10 sons, they appear in front of her like this and say, "Mom, identify us." They say that in chorus. And mom is perplexed because she cannot see the faces of her sons. But then, I told you something, they are all of different heights. So do you think it will be difficult for the mom to identify who is who? All 10 sons are masked and they appear in front of their mom and say, "Mom, identify us," hoping that they'll make the mom perplexed and that she'll not be able to identify them. Little do they know that mom can identify her sons just by identifying their heights. She knows that the shortest is this, the second shortest is this, third is this, and so on up to the tallest, who is this. And she goes on in no time, calling out their names, patting on their back one at a time. She says, "Atri, Bhrigu, Kutra, Vashishta, Gautama, Kashyapa, Angirasa, Rama, Bhima, Shama," over all 10 names. Right? What exactly did she use to identify them? Just their heights. And what's the moral? The moral is that despite the fact that sons concealed their identity with a mask, mother used some other parameter. So what's the moral of the story? Why this story amidst our encryption-decryption theory? Do you see a connection? Well, there indeed is a connection, and this is the connection. You can try to conceal the letters in the form of symbols, but then, you see, English speaks out aloud. What do I mean by this? English has a very peculiar statistical property. Sounds complicated? Nothing at all. I just mean the following. The most frequently occurring letter in English always happens to be this. Isn't this a beautiful idea? It sounds as though it's impossible for anyone to decode a substitution of the letters of English alphabet with some random symbols. It looks like it's impossible to break this code. But you see how English speaks out aloud, and anybody can very easily decrypt the text. This seemingly complicated looking technique has a huge loophole. In fact, it is as easy as the previous one that we discussed. So, the subject is called cryptography, where the idea is all about making ciphers and also breaking it. Almost every single technique that has come about in the history is broken, and the ones that is currently in place, I believe, are just in the status of yet to be broken. So the science of secrecy is all about making and breaking the codes. It is richer than what I illustrated just now. I invite you all to read more of it. I'll give you some references to good books for the same. You can go ahead and read more of what makes cryptography.
The professor just now explained a method to share your messages secretly. So let me try to show you how can you share your messages in a secret way. Hello everyone, before we start doing the program for substitution cipher, I would like to explain a concept in Python named string. So first of all, what is a string? String is used to represent text in Python. Text may comprise of spaces, numbers, and even alphabets. So how can you use string here? For that, first of all, you need to import a library called string. Now I would take a variable named x and I would initialize it to a string. For example, it is hello world. Please note the fact that every time you initialize a string, you have to enclose the string in double quotes. You have to enclose the string in double quotes. So here we have the string called hello world. And if you want to access a particular alphabet in the string X, what we can do here is we can access the particular alphabet in string hello world by giving it a particular number. For example, if I want to access H in hello world, I would write print X of 0. As you know, the indexing starts from 0 in arrays as well as in strings. So if I want to access the alphabet H in hello world, that would start from 0. So H is at 0th position. So I would write print X of 0. So here we have H. And for example, if I want to access the alphabet O here, O has two occurrences. So if I want to access the alphabet O in the first position, that is, how can you do it? H is at 0th position, E is at 1st position, L is at 2nd, 2nd L is at 3rd position, and that O is at 4th position. Since O is at 4th position, I'll write X of 4, and now let us see what is the output. Here we have O. So this is how you can access the alphabets at particular position in a string. Okay. There are many other functions available in string. For example, if we want to access the alphabets from 2nd position to 5th position, how can you do that? You can actually do it in one go without even using for loop and any kind of loop. So I'll just say X of 2 colon 5. And I'll just print. So it prints LLO. This is how you can access the alphabets in a particular range of positions. Okay. Now if I want to get the length of the string, so for that you have a function. What you need to do is write LEN and then an LEN and in bracket write the name of the string. Here we have X, so we will write X. So let us print it. So it is 11. You can clearly see that the length of the string X is 11. Now if you want to convert the string X in uppercase, there is straight away a function available in Python. What we can do here is you just write the name of the string, that is X, and then dot, and then you have to write upper. Upper is a function available in Python used to convert the available string in uppercase. So now let us see what is the output. For that we should print it, print X dot upper. Yes, it converts the string, our string hello world, to uppercase. So we are done with strings. Now there is one more function available in Python. In fact, there are many more functions, but here I would like to explain you one more. For example, in hello world, if I want to replace one alphabet by some other alphabet, how can you do that? I'll just write X dot replace. For example, I want to replace H with J. So I'll just write replace H in double quotes, comma, then J in double quotes. So now the output is Jello World instead of Hello World. So this is about strings in Python. Now we will do the program for substitution cipher and we'll use strings there. So let us try to code substitution cipher here. For substitution cipher, we have an input file here named ip_file. It has some text. I need to convert this text in such a way so that it is not recognized by the third person. For that, I'll be using substitution cipher. So for that, I need a string of alphabets. in which I can substitute the letters. Python provides us with a string named string.sky_letters. I'll print it. So I'll write print string.sky_letters. As you can see, we have the letters in lowercase as well as in the uppercase. So I'll be substituting this string in such a way so that it is not recognized. The text present in our input file is not recognized by the third person. I'll be using this particular string for that. So in order to execute the substitution part, I'll write import string. After that, I'll initialize a dictionary called dict. I hope you are already familiar with dictionaries, strings, as well as file handling, because we'll be using all three of them in this particular program. And if you are not familiar with these concepts, I would suggest you to go through the previous videos. Please go through the previous videos and then watch this programming screencast. Now we have dictionary named dict is equal to dict is equal to curly braces. This is how we initialize a dictionary. For converting this particular string to a substituted format, I'll write for I in range length string dot ascii underscore letters. In this particular dictionary, if any letter is at ith position, I'll be substituting it by I minus 1th position letter. It's your choice with which letter you want to substitute a particular letter. Here, if I am substituting the letter, a given letter, by the previous letter, so we will have here A will be substituted by Z, B would be substituted by A, C would be substituted by B, D would be substituted by C. This is how our dictionary is going to work. So I'll write string dot ascii letters, string dot ascii underscore letters at ith position will be substituted by string dot ascii underscore letters at I minus 1th position. Here I used minus 1. You can even use plus 1, plus 2, even minus 2, minus 3. It's your wish. I'm substituting it by minus 1th letter so that you can get a clear cut idea of how our program is working. It would be easy to observe this particular dictionary. So I'll just print dictionary here so that you can get a clear cut idea of what is happening over here. So here we have the dictionary. As you can see, capital Z is A substituted by capital Z, B is substituted by A, C substituted by B, D substituted by C. This is how our substitution is working. So we have all the substitutions in this particular dictionary named dict. Now we will use this dictionary dict to convert our input file. For that, first of all, we need to open our input file named ip underscore file. So I'll write with open ip underscore file dot txt as f, then I'll write while true. I need to read this file character by character and I need to substitute a particular character according to the dictionary. So I'll take a variable here named c. C is equal to f dot read
Now, I need to check one or two things here. First of all, I'll be checking whether we have encountered end of file or not. For that, I'll write if not C. If the file pointer hasn't encountered any character, that means it has reached end of file. So in this particular case, we will print end of file and it will break out of this file loop. And if the file pointer has encountered a C which is already present in the dictionary, if C indict, in that particular case I'll take a string here named data. Please initialize the string data here. How can you do that? You can initialize through double quotes. So we have initialized our string data. Data is equal to dict of C. If C is present in dictionary, in that particular case, data will be equal to dict of C. And if C is not present in the dictionary, then we can't do anything. We'll just write data is equal to C instead of dict of C. Please note the fact that in our dictionary dict, only alphabets are present in lowercase as well as in uppercase. And if in our file some integers 0 to 9 or some special symbols are present, that will not be substituted. So here is an exercise for you. If you encounter a file with some special symbols and integers, how can you apply substitution cipher on that particular file? It's an exercise to you, it's left to you. How can you do that? So here we have the string data which has the substituted file, which has a substituted data. So I'll just print it. I'll just write print data. Let us try to print this. So now we have the data, but the data is exactly like the input file. So there is some error in our program. Here if we are reading the file, we need to supply a boolean value here. So I'll just supply 1 and try to read it. Here we have the substituted file. So here is the mistake. When we are reading the file, we need to supply some boolean value here, 1 here. So as you can see that it has substituted our input file, and this is something we can't read and we can't recognize. Okay, so what will I do here is I'll store this output in a file so that you can get a clear-cut idea of the substitution happening over here. So I'll take another file here named file is equal to open op underscore file dot txt, and I'll open this file in writing mode since we need to write it. And what next we need to do here is I need to write this particular string data in our file. So I'll just write here file dot write, and then curly braces we'll write data. Okay, after we are done with the writing part, I'll close this file. I write file dot close round braces. So now let us try to run this program again. So here we have the substituted text. Let us open the file output file op underscore file. And as you can see here, we have the data in the substituted form. This is something we can't recognize. We can't figure out that this text was actually this, and we have substituted it using substitution cipher. So now we are done with the program. I'll go through the program again. First of all, there is a string present in Python named string.ascii_letters. We use this string for the substitution part. Here we are substituting the letters present in the string by i-1th letter. Here we have, for that we are using dictionary. We have initialized the dictionary here named dict. After that we are executing the substitution part. In this particular part, we are writing dict string.ascii_letters at ith position will be substituted by i-1th letter. This is how we are doing the substitution. Please note that dictionaries have keys and value. In this particular dictionary, keys are the letters present in the string and the values are the substituted letters. I repeat, keys are the values present in the string and values are the substituted letters. After that, we are opening our file, our input file, and we are reading it character by character. For that, we need to supply a boolean variable here, 1, so as to read the file character by character. Then we are checking some conditions here. First condition we are checking here is whether we have encountered the end of file or not. If we have encountered end of file, in that particular case, our program will print end of file and it will break out of this loop. And then we are checking if the particular character present in the input file is actually present in our dictionary. If it is not present, then it will only write the C in data. Otherwise, if it is present, then it will write dict of C, the substituted letter in the data. At the end, we are writing this string data in an output file so that we can get a clear cut idea of how the substitution is working. And then we are printing the data and finally we are closing the file. So as you can see here, we have two files here. This is the output file and this is the input file. Here in input file you can read the text, but in output file, the output file is converted to some other text using the substitution cipher, which is not recognized, which can't be recognized by the third person until and unless he gets to know that substitution cipher is used here. So this is how you can code for substitution cipher and convert many more text. I hope this programming screencast was useful to you guys. Happy learning!
Do you remember this? Do you remember this? And this? Yes, our next show is about tic-tac-toe.
That was such a good time. We used to play a lot of games in our childhood. I was just going through some of my old notebooks. My rough notebook would look something like this when you scan it from back. I guess most of you are getting this nostalgic memories on seeing this. This is the famous game called tic-tac-toe, which we all used to play in our childhood. We loved playing it. It's such a enjoyable, it's such a good memories. We are reliving it. This feels so great. So in this lecture series, I would take you down your memory lane. You all shall relive your childhood days the fun way through computing. That were good old memories. We all had almost played this game in our childhood. For those who want to relive those memorable days, I would start with the rules of the game. The game is something like this. There is a 3x3 board, which is nothing but a board containing three rows and 3 columns, that is a total of 9 cells. There are 2 players involved in this game. Each player is given a symbol. One is given a symbol X, one is given a symbol O. They are supposed to alternate their turns. During their turn, the player is expected to occupy a vacant slot in the board. When they alternate their turns, the one who is able to occupy 3 slots such that the 3 slots come in one single row or the 3 slots come in one single column or they occur along this diagonal or this diagonal, one of the diagonals. The one who is able to do this first is considered the winner. This is how the game goes. If no one is able to occupy their positions in such a manner, then it is declared a draw. No one wins. This is how the game goes. I hope most of you had gone back to your childhood days. If you would observe the rules of the game, this is much more than you playing to establish your victory. This is much more than that. The planning, the thinking involved requires a lot of envisioning ability. You need to envision what would be your move as well as what could be the move your opponent would make given his next turn. You have to envision both. You would play such that you increase your chances, you maximize your chances of winning as well as you minimize the chances that your opponent wins. This is how the intelligent player would play this game. So when both players play intelligently, the game would mostly be a draw. This particular strategy where you want to maximize the chances of your winning and minimize the chances of your opponent's winning is called the min-max strategy. This is the min-max strategy, which is a very famous game strategy, and all such min-max games are too thrilling. And given that this is a Joy of Computing course, we would now see how we shall play this game the fun way using computers.